Very good afternoon to all of you. And on behalf of Sri Lanka Medical Association, I welcome everyone for this very important webinar, which is on vaccines and diagnostics, all you need to know. This is a very important topic. And we can see there is a lot of interest and enthusiasm regarding this webinar, because this is a topic that everyone is interested about and curious about at the current moment. This very important series of webinars is conducted in collaboration with Sri Lanka Medical Association and World Health Organization. Today we are having the second webinar on a very timely topic. And this webinar too is conducted in collaboration with Sri Lanka College of Microbiologists. And I would like to now invite and welcome my co-chair, Professor Nadira Karunavira, who is the president of the Sri Lanka College of Microbiologists. Dr. Karunavira, over to you.
Thank you, Indika. A very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of the Sri Lanka College of Microbiologists. As Indika quite correctly mentioned, this webinar will deal with two extremely important areas related to COVID-19. Those are the vaccines and diagnostics. So let me ask Indika again, give it back to Indika to introduce and invite the first speaker of the session.
Thank you, Professor Nadira. As I mentioned previously, the series of webinars is a joint activity between SLMA and World Health Organization. Today, we have a very important resource person, very eminent resource persons lined up, and we starting with none other than the WHO representative of Sri Lanka, Dr. Asia Pense, who has done pioneering work related to the COVID-19 control in the country. Over to you, Dr. Asia. Dr. Asia Pense.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Professor Karunathilake. May I share my screen?
Yes, please, you can.
Once again, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for inviting WHO to be one of the presenters in this very important webinar. And I was asked to kind of weigh in on the country readiness for the COVID-19 vaccine. Just a reminder to all of us that the pandemic is still accelerating in many parts of the world. And as of 7 p.m. Central European time, 26 November, WHO was reported of over 60 million cases and 1.4 million deaths. While we are waiting for a therapeutic breakthrough, there has been some exciting news on the vaccination front, and this will be one of the very important interventions in our fight against the pandemic. Having said that, it's important to also realize that vaccine will be an additionality and will not replace the existing public health and social measures that we need to take. In terms of the COVID-19 vaccine, as we are getting more and more efficacy readouts for different candidate vaccines, I'm told that Professor Neelika would be talking about the landscape of the available vaccines. I'll be focusing more on introduction of the vaccine at country level. So the outline would be, I'll just focusing on the COVAX facility, which is one of the very important access frameworks that have been done globally in order to have equitable access to vaccine across the globe. Then a little update on the regulatory approvals, and then the country readiness, what are the measures and what are the tools already available from the World Health Organization. So quickly, COVAX is a facility that has been set up by WHO, Gavi and CEPI very early. Actually, the work on the ACT Accelerator started in April of 2020. And vaccine is one of the components of the equitable access to diagnostics, therapeutics, and vaccines for COVID-19 globally. And the objective of the COVAX, which is the vaccine pillar of the ACT Accelerator, is to end the acute phase of the pandemic by 2021. And this is through delivery of 2 billion doses by the end of 2021. And in order to have to end the pandemic, it's very important that few people all across the globe get access to vaccine and not all people in few countries. This is a lesson that was learned from the H1N1 pandemic, when few countries had access to all the vaccines and large number of LMIC countries were left wanting for the vaccine. And in the other aspect is because we have seen a very accelerated pace of development for vaccines. Generally, it takes around 10 years for a candidate vaccine to be available in terms of safety and efficacy. For the COVID-19, this has happened within 1 year. So the facility also aims to support the largest actively managed portfolio so that there are options available for securing the doses and subsequent supply to countries. And of course, it's a compelling return on investment, because for the trillions that have been lost to the global economy because of the COVID-19, the investment in billions is what is needed. So it's actually investment in billions for a return in trillions. The COVAX facility, for the first time, this is not a facility which is targeting only lower and lower middle income countries. There are 187 confirmed eligible participants across the globe. And you can see most of the countries are already part of the COVAX. And it has those in red are the self-financing countries who will be paying up for the vaccine doses. Those in blue are the 92 AMC or the advanced market commitment countries who will be provided with the vaccination, with the funding support for the initial 20% population coverage of COVID-19 vaccine. Sri Lanka is one of the AMC 92 countries. So this is another way of looking at it. The COVAX facility looks at countries both within the AMC as well outside of the AMC. And the aim is to get 2 billion doses specifically to LMICs by the end of 2021. And there will be official development assistance available to the AMC eligible countries. It is an innovative financing instrument, which has been used the first time in a public health response to a global emergency. And the objectives are threefold. One is to accelerate the availability of effective vaccine, to secure the doses for equitable distribution across the globe, and that leads to the affordability for most of the people across the globe and not to a select few. And the impact that is envisioned is to protect primarily in the first cut would be the healthcare workers and the most vulnerable population. And the other impact that we are looking at to prevent the transmission of COVID-19. As I said, 1 year into the pandemic, we are still seeing an acceleration in many parts of the world. And the COVID-19 pandemic has shown us that how health and economy are closely intertwined, and this pandemic has affected both lives and livelihoods and disrupted societies, economies, and brought in a lot of disruption across the globe. Now, in terms of to have a robust portfolio of different candidate vaccines so as to facilitate access to the doses as they become available for fair distribution across multiple countries. The facility aspires to have a robust, diversified portfolio. And as you would all know, that we still do not have a vaccine that has been as yet approved by a regulatory authority. What we have are just efficacy readouts. We're still waiting for safety data. But in terms of this innovative facility, there has been a lot of work that has been done in advance. And there are already existing MOUs between the COVAX facility and the vaccine manufacturers. So that is the two main front runner vaccines, which are viral vector vaccines, AstraZeneca and Sanofi GSK. That is, the Serum Institute of India will be one of the major manufacturing sites for availability of the vaccine doses, especially for LMICs. So the MOUs are already existing between these three entities and the COVAX facility, and there is an active lookout for other candidate vaccines as they become available for co-opting into the COVAX facility. And in terms of getting the candidates into the COVAX portfolio, what we're looking at is a diversity in terms of the available candidate vaccines. And as perhaps will be presented later in other presentation, that the COVID-19 vaccine uses multiple platforms. The other important thing is to have the regional scope and scalability so that even countries with poorer healthcare systems are able to access and scale up vaccination at population level. To also have the economies of scale in terms of pricing, the negotiations are done by the COVAX on behalf of the participating countries, and to ensure that there are doses available so that a staggered distribution could be done so that every country within the facility gets access to the doses. And in terms of the vaccine profile, before a candidate vaccine is included in the portfolio, of course, important would be the efficacy and immunogenicity, and these readouts are coming in, have started to come in. The safety profiles, we are awaiting data from at least the vaccines that have already submitted or shared the efficacy data. Then it increases the probability of success because we will have a diversified portfolio of vaccines, programmatic feasibility, also to look at delivery considerations. As I said, there are different platforms, so there is a differential requirement in terms of storage of the vaccines. Now, as I said, that the number of doses that would be available initially would be restricted. And given that the pandemic has impacted too. So this is just kind of, one of the important aspects is the allocation framework and the population prioritization for introduction and scale up of COVID-19. This is an allocation framework that the facility has done based on the values framework. So the first cut would be targeting the healthcare workers who are at high or very high risk of acquiring and transmitting the infection, other frontline workers, and older adults based on the age and risk specific profiles, who are most vulnerable to the morbidity and mortality. In stage two, which will be from up to 11 to 20% of the population coverage, we're expecting vaccine doses to start rollout mid-2021. And by end of 2021, we're expecting that 20% of these doses will be available to countries. So this would be factoring in individuals with comorbidities and other priority populations. And then beyond 20%, that would be other healthcare workers, other essential workers, and basically that would be to expand the access of vaccination to reduce the disruption in terms of social and economic functions. Now, this is kind of, not very easy to read, but basically this is a readout of the efficacy data that has been shared for the four candidates. Two of them are mRNA platform vaccines and two are viral vector vaccines. The efficacy for three is in the range of 90 and above, and the AstraZeneca readout efficacy readout that was made available earlier this week, there is some issues with the data because one of the subgroups received half of the dose, the first dose of the vaccine, and surprisingly the efficacy was higher in that group. We are awaiting full readout in terms of the data for the AstraZeneca. And as you would see that the safety concerns for the viral vector vaccines are still awaited. in terms of the regulatory pathway, because for WHO, we are awaiting that submission of the data to the WHO regulatory framework. And there are also rolling reviews with the stringent regulatory authorities. For all the vaccines, this is ongoing. In terms of when these the earliest potential complete submission to WHO for these candidate vaccines would happen. So these are the 10 candidate vaccines currently in phase three. And you would see that we are expecting submission to start beginning, coming in next year onwards. And it's only after these regulatory approvals are obtained that this purchase to the facility will begin. Moving on to the country readiness and delivery of the vaccine, there are some important decisions that have to be made at the policy level, as well as address some of the technical and operational issues. And as I said, first important thing is to have the prioritization in terms of which population groups the country will start vaccination for. And because it would be a staggered delivery, it's very important and critical to identify what the policy of vaccinating at the public health level would be in the candidate country. What is the status of regulatory approvals and for the vaccines as it comes in? Because some countries may accept the WHO because it will be an emergency use listing, or if they have been approved by stringent regulatory authorities like the EU or FDA, and other countries may actually require stringent regulatory approvals from national authorities. And then the other, in terms of the prioritization, it is also important given that there are different platform vaccines with differential requirements of cold chain, what are the vaccines that the country is looking at? So from the COVAX point of view, currently we do not have the mRNA vaccines. However, the facility is discussing with countries if some of the AMC countries would be willing to introduce at very small scale the ultra cold chain vaccine. Other important factor is the financing, ensuring the fiscal space. Even though the first 20% of the population coverage would be coming to the AMC countries at no cost, there would be other requirements in terms of preparing the health systems for delivery of these vaccines, in terms for just the number of doses that would need to be given in a limited time would be much more than the regular routine immunization. For example, this is a vaccine that will have to be given to adults and not children, of which the systems are largely constructed. And then also to monitor adverse effects following immunization, given that it's a compressed timeline in terms of safety and efficacy readouts. So we'll need a very robust framework for monitoring adverse effects, and also having communication with the population, because A, the access would be limited to fewer number of people, and B, in terms of getting the buy-in of the communities for a vaccine that has been developed at an accelerated pace. The other thing would be access to financing, whether it will be available from domestic resources or it would be through multilateral channels like the development banks, for example. Other very important aspect of introduction of COVID-19, and even for countries to get the doses free from COVAX, is that the countries are allowed to sign in on indemnification and liability. This is a requirement by the manufacturers because it's a vaccine that has come in very quickly. However, the COVAX facility, specifically Gavi, is looking at a global monitoring framework to look into adverse events, severe adverse events, and the compensation following those. But the countries will have to upfront sign the indemnification and liability. There will be technical and operational issues, some of which I've already said, in terms of the cold chain, health facilities, upgrade, the training of the healthcare workers, because some of these vaccines may have differential dosing. For example, the Pfizer vaccine is at 0.3 ml dose, although it is not in the COVAX as yet. to have the national deployment and vaccination plan, because this is critical, because the vaccine readiness, and so the vaccine request, to COVAX will have to be submitted by the AMC countries by December 7th, and to do the key bottleneck analysis upfront, so that when the vaccine is actually available, it can be smoothly deployed and delivered. So these are some of the tools that are already available and has been shared. The global support one would be especially the strategic advisory group of experts on immunization. The values framework has already been developed, based on which the prioritization has happened. And now we are looking at specific recommendation based on data that would be available for candidate vaccines. The National Immunization Technical Advisory Groups, the network has already been engaged at a global level, and discussions have already started. In terms of the regulatory and safety monitoring, WHO, even though this is a compressed timeline, it in no way it means that there would be any compromise in terms of the efficacy and specifically safety of these vaccines. So all the processes are already have been put in place to ensure that the all requirements that are needed, the criteria, the call for expression of interest, the engagement with manufacturers, the safety monitoring mechanisms, all are being put in place, so that once the vaccine is available and is sent to countries, that there would be robust efficacy and safety data. The critical resources for country readiness, there is the vaccine introduction readiness assessment tool. Already countries have started to fill in, and the data is being populated to look at the country readiness. There's also a vaccine readiness assessment framework of the World Bank, which looks at financing and specifically accessing the $12 billion that have been set aside by the World Bank for supporting 100 countries introduce and scale up COVID-19 vaccine. The guidance to develop the national deployment and vaccination plan was released on November 16th. It has already been shared by all the countries, and we are hoping that those plans would be done as soon as possible. And these are some of the chapters of the national deployment and vaccination plan, which looks at regulatory preparedness, planning and coordination, the costing and financing, prioritization of population groups, what the vaccine delivery strategy should be, what is the preparedness that is needed in terms of the supply chain and logistics, the human resource management and training, the vaccine acceptance and uptake, that is demand generation and managing expectations of the communities, the vaccine safety monitoring, especially management of AEFIs, injection safety, the monitoring systems, especially in terms of the COVID-19 surveillance as the vaccine is introduced, and finally, evaluation of the COVID-19 vaccine introduction. In case a country does decide to take on an ultra cold chain vaccine, it will have higher delivery costs because there would be non-standard cold chain requirements. And generally the costing that has been done is that it would be $0.8 to $2.38 additional cost per dose of the vaccine delivered at ultra cold chain compared to 2 to 8 degrees. And as I said, the additional consideration, for example, Pfizer is 0.3 ml, so it will require a non-standard vaccine volume. Then health worker training in terms of handling ultra cold chain vaccines, and especially like handling dry ice. And because the vaccine, generally the what the package insert currently saying is that it will be 5 doses to a vial, and that will have to be delivered within 6 hours. So there are some of the complexities in terms of the ultra cold chain vaccines. Some of the upcoming resources, especially in terms of operational guidance, trainings, those modules are currently being developed, and these would be available to the countries as the vaccine, in preparation of the receipt and deployment and delivery of vaccines. Just to say that it is a combined effort. Everyone is, it's really an example of solidarity across agencies, across countries, to ensure that we have equitable access to the COVID-19 vaccine, which is a very critical tool to address the disruptions both for lives and livelihoods that the COVID-19 has unleashed in almost in every country, in every territory globally. That's all from me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Asya Fensay, for that very valuable information. I think many have benefited from the information that was given to you, because everyone has a lot of concerns and there are a lot of clarifications to be made. And while thanking all the participants for their excellent participation, may I kindly request, if you have your microphones on, please mute them unless you are speaking or making a presentation. So let's move into the next section, and I'd like to invite Professor Nadira Karunavira to invite the next two speakers. Professor Nadira, over to you.
Thank you, Indika. Before I move on to the second speaker, I also would like to thank Dr. Asya Fensay on behalf of the College of Microbiologists for that excellent presentation, for sharing those information with us. I'm sure it's of great interest to all participants. And when you look at the number of participants who are engaged with this webinar, you can figure out the level of interest. And I also would like to ask the participants, if they do have any questions, please type in your questions in the chat box so that the speakers could have a look and even respond if possible, because at the end, if there's time, we certainly would allow questions. Otherwise, they will type in the questions. So now to move on to the next speaker, Professor Neelika Malaige. She is no stranger to the local audience, I'm sure. She is a professor in the Department of Immunology and Molecular Medicine, and she's also the director of Dengue Research Institute at University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Neelika is very well known in dengue, in the field of dengue, and I'm glad she was able to use her expertise to move on to the field of COVID. And she's going to share her knowledge on vaccines, different types of vaccines and so on in COVID. So over to you, Neelika.
Thank you, madam, for that introduction. So I'll just share my screen. All right. So I'll
you
be
can
talking.
Put it on full screen. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. So I'll be talking about. Thank you for the invitation to talk about COVID-19 vaccines, which is something that everybody is discussing. So I hope that at the end of what we discuss, then we know where we stand as far as vaccines are concerned. So what I would like to talk about is the concept of herd immunity, because as far as, for instance, in certain vaccines like measles, we use the vaccine to induce herd immunity and stop transmission altogether. In some vaccines like influenza, we vaccinate people to reduce the risk of complications and death. So each vaccine, you have a different idea why you use the vaccine. Then I'll talk about the type of vaccines, because some people are confused what an mRNA vaccine is, because that's a new type of vaccine, and what safety issues we are looking for. To start off with herd immunity, I think everybody is very familiar with the concept of herd immunity. So basically, when there are no immune people in a population, and when there is introduction of a particular virus or bacteria, a lot of individuals are infected because of intense transmission. But when more and more people are immune to a particular virus or bacteria, then the transmission cycle is broken. So although not all are immune to a particular bacteria or virus, the transmission cycle is halted. So depending on the infectivity or the infectiousness of a pathogen, the amount of herd immunity needed to stop transmission is sort of been calculated. So if you take something like measles, which is a very highly transmissible infection by aerosols, And the R naught value of measles is given around 12 to 18, which is that every person with measles infect 12 or 18 individuals, you need a very high herd immunity, around 90 to 94% to stop infection. On the other hand, if you take something like H1N1 with a R naught value of 1.6, so every individual with H1N1 influenza would infect 1.6 individuals, you can achieve herd immunity by giving 40% of individuals being immune. So now, where does SARS-CoV-2 stand? So now, different studies give this R naught value for SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19. It varies, but basically, it is thought to be around 3 to 5.7 to 8%. So I think this is a median value of 5.7. So the herd immunity for SARS-CoV-2 is thought to be around 8 to 2.5. To stop transmission. Now that is a very high value of 82.5 individuals having to be immune to stop transmission. But as I began with the start of this talk, now there are different aims of vaccination. If you take influenza, we don't vaccinate everybody in the population to induce immunity so that we break the transmission. Whereas in certain infections like mumps, measles, we make sure that there is a good herd immunity to stop transmission. So as far as COVID is concerned, I think everybody would want to have a good immunity level in the population to stop transmission. But how long that will take with the use of vaccines is a different question, which we need to discuss. Now, there has been a lot of concern that because of this rapid development of vaccines, whether we have taken shortcuts, or in other words, all these vaccine developers have taken shortcuts, and therefore there's a safety concerns. So as Dr. Razia has said, usually for the time of development, to the time a vaccine is available, it would take at least 15 years or longer. Sometimes the shortest duration would be 10 years. So all the vaccines we are currently using right now have been gone through such a long duration of development. So we know the safety profile, the efficacy profile, and all that very well. But in this instance, actually, shortcuts, you can't say the shortcuts have been taken, because most of these vaccine constructs have been under development. So if I give an example of the Oxford vaccine, which is a chimpanzee adenovirus, they had also already used that chimpanzee adenovirus instead of the SARS-CoV-2. They had the SARS-CoV-1, which was the previous coronavirus the construct was made. They had already done the preclinical trials, they had already done animal studies, and they had all that data. So it's just they substituted SARS-CoV-1 to SARS-CoV-2. So all that, this initial data, which takes about 2 to 4 years, those studies had already been done. For most of these vaccines. So that is one reason that the vaccine manufacturing development could speed up. And another thing that happened during the SARS-CoV-2 vaccine development was overlapping of stages. So usually you have phase one, and then you analyze all the data, and then apply for stage two, analyze all the data, then apply for stage three. But here there was overlap between stages, and in the middle of phase one, you do interim analysis, apply for stage two. In the middle of stage two, you do a phase two, you do a interim analysis, and apply for stage three, so that the vaccine development makes it faster. So actually, you can't say that shortcuts were taken because of the urgent need for a vaccine. These urgent reviews of these grant the ethics applications, the safety data and efficacy data was made so that you could move on to the next phase. Now, there are 10 different vaccines currently under phase 3 clinical trials, and they have different vaccine platforms. Some of them are the traditional platforms, and some are new platforms, which I'll talk about. So I'll just highlight these three important platforms, which are the leading vaccines. One of these platforms is very familiar to everybody, the inactivated vaccines. So quite a lot of vaccines that are currently in use, that we use on a daily basis, are these formalin inactivated vaccines. So two of these Chinese vaccines are these formalin inactivated vaccines. I don't think I need to talk about it anymore because people are familiar with it. So then another type of vaccine is this replicant incompetent vector vaccine. So what do you mean by replication incompetent? That means when you inject this virus into a host, the virus doesn't replicate within that host. And then you insert the gene of interest into that viral vector. And in this instance, this is a spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, because that is it is from this spike protein that the virus binds to the ACE2 receptor and causes infection. So the idea is, and most of the neutralizing antibodies are directed to this spike protein. So the idea is, if you block this this protein, then you can stop infection. The other type of vaccine is this mRNA vaccine. So that has it's packed in a liposome or a lipid nanoparticle, and in the middle it has a mRNA strand. So it is just a mRNA, and this will be translated by a ribosome. It will not be incorporated into your genome. Now, so these are some of the leading vaccines, and the preliminary results of phase 1 and 2 are published in most trials, but the phase 2 trial results have not been published in most of these vaccines, except for the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which the phase 2-3 results, the middle of phase 2, end of phase 2, beginning of phase 3 results have been published in a peer-reviewed journal. And of course, the temperature that you need to store these vaccines differ very much. The Pfizer vaccine, which is an mRNA vaccine, needs to be stored at minus 70. The Moderna vaccine, which is again mRNA vaccine, needs to be stored at minus 20. The other ones can be stored in the refrigerator. So I'll just give examples of certain platforms. So one of these important platforms is this Oxford vaccine, which everybody is talking about, and one of the leading ones. So it has used a chimpanzee adenovirus, and so they had already developed it for SARS-CoV-1. And in this chimpanzee adenovirus, they have inserted the S protein of the SARS-CoV-2. And so this is the modified adenovirus. The reason that they have used a chimpanzee adenovirus is because if you take a human adenovirus, humans can have had so many, it's a common human virus, and people might already have antibodies to the adenovirus. And so the vaccine efficacy might not be as good if you use a human adenovirus. But having said that, although Oxford has used the chimpanzee adenovirus, some vaccine manufacturers have used a human adenovirus. So we have to wait and see the efficacy of those. And it's a non-replicating virus. So the virus will not replicate within the host. Then this mRNA vaccine approach. So the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccines have this mRNA. You have mRNA inside this liposome or a lipid nanoparticle. It is injected into the muscle. Then this lipid nanoparticle goes inside muscle cells. It releases the mRNA, and the mRNA is directly translated by ribosome. And so then the viral proteins are expressed, which are expressed on the cell surface, so you develop antibodies against it. And also it is processed through these proteasomes and uploaded onto the relevant molecules, so you generate a T-cell response as well. So these mRNA vaccines generate both antibody and a T-cell response. And so when it comes to vaccines, we have several questions that we need to ask. The most important question is, of course, the seroconversion, or the presence of neutralizing antibodies to the virus associated with protection. Now, for some viruses, we know that it does. Measles, mumps, and so on. If you have seroconversion or the presence of neutralizing antibodies, that is associated with protection. But if you take certain vaccines like the dengue vaccine, we know from all the data that is out there and what has happened after the vaccine was registered, that seroconversion or the presence of neutralizing antibodies to the dengue vaccine was not associated with protection. So that is one question we need to answer. Then, of course, how long do these antibodies last following vaccination? Again, with the existing data for the SARS-CoV-2, we know that certain people don't seem to have antibodies after 3 to 4 months after initial infection. And our own studies in Sri Lanka have also shown that around 50% of individuals with mild and asymptomatic infection lose their detectable antibodies after 3 to 4 months. But of course, just because they lose the antibodies, that doesn't mean that they are susceptible, because apart from antibodies, there are so many other different mechanisms in your immune system that would prevent reinfection. But this is just about antibodies. Then, of course, how important is the development of T cell responses to a vaccine? So for some vaccines don't generate a huge T cell response like the hepatitis B vaccine, whereas you get protection. Whereas if you take a vaccine like the chickenpox vaccine, that induces a strong T cell response, and the major part of the protection from varicella is from this T cell response. And the other questions, does the vaccine prevent both mild and severe illness, or does it just prevent, it causes infection, but just prevent severe illness? Do we need yearly booster doses? Because if you don't have long-lasting immunity, will it be another influenza vaccine that you have to keep on giving booster doses? And what are the long-term side effects, such as vaccine-induced disease enhancement? So now this is about the vaccine race. Now there has been a lot of talk in the media, and unfortunately only in the media, all these vaccine manufacturers have released their phase three interim analysis results through media and not through scientific publications. So as Dr. Asia said, all these vaccines are currently undergoing phase three clinical trials. The phase three clinical trials will end towards the end of December and January. And only after that, we will have the full data. But still, their interim analysis was released into the media. And the interim analysis from what they have released looks promising. So the Pfizer, they said they immunized 43,500 something people, and 94 individuals got infected, but we don't know who exactly. And so the people who analyzed this data, based on the media reports, of course, say that maybe the vaccine is not 90% effective, but still more than the 50% efficacy that is expected by the FDA. But of course, the question is, how long the immunity lasts, whether it's for 3 months, 6 months, or later, because this data is for like 1.5 months and 2 months. Okay. And then just after this, the Russian vaccine Sputnik announced their data again through a press release. And their analysis was based on 20 individuals. So based on just analysis of 20 individuals, 3 weeks after giving the vaccine or placebo. So 3 weeks is not a very short time. And interim analysis of 20 cases, is the number is very small. So basically, the experts are, of course, saying it's difficult to conclude anything from 20 events. But they say their vaccine is 95% efficacious based on the interim analysis of 20 cases and 3 weeks after immunizing. Then, of course, Moderna came out showing that their data is 94% efficacious. Their vaccine, again, we don't have any data of how many severe infections, how many mild, or any of the questions I've been discussing about. The Oxford vaccine had two protocols, a high dose and low dose protocol. That was not intentional. And the two protocols gave two different types of data. One was 90% efficacious, the other was 62%. So in the 90% efficacious arm, they had given half dose as the initial vaccine dose instead of the full dose. And that was by accidental calculation, which led to good results. Again, so these are the efficacy data, analyzing 131 cases. But still, this trial is ongoing. But to give credit to the Oxford vaccine, they have published their end of phase 2 trial data, and they are the only vaccine manufacturer so far, developer so far, who have tested this vaccine in old individuals. And this is really important, because as you grow old, especially after you're 70 years of age, your immune system, you have this thing called immunosenescence, or in other words, your immune system doesn't respond well to new pathogens. And so they have tested their vaccine in over 70-year-olds, 56 to 69-year-olds, and 18 to 55-year-olds. And as you can see, the vaccine efficacy is the same irrespective of the age group, which was good. And then, of course, the side effects of the vaccine was less in the older age group. And one important thing about this vaccine, I would like to say, is in their publication, they have said that immune correlates of protection are not known, but if it is the presence of neutralizing antibodies, then this is good news. So it is important that we understand that we simply do not know whether the presence of neutralizing antibodies associated with protection, and that is something that only time will tell. Then, of course, was the Sinovac, that is a Chinese vaccine, inactivated vaccine, and they released their results again from a press release. And so they say that their vaccine induces quick antibody responses at day 14. Because of that, they believe that it's suitable for emergency use because it induces quick antibody responses. But the neutralizing antibody levels induced by this particular vaccine was lower than the other vaccines. So this is the phase one data that they had published. And again, there are no data in old individuals, and there was good seroconversion rates to this vaccine, although the neutralizing antibody levels were lower than the other vaccines. But based on their quick antibody responses, as seen with all other vaccines, they think it's good for emergency use. And currently, it is undergoing clinical trials in several countries. Now, of course, the chairman of this vaccine manufacturer has says that 1 million doses have already been given to so many Chinese individuals, and only some individuals had mild symptoms after exposure or with the vaccines is not very clear. But that is the state of that vaccine. So this is just comparing the neutralizing antibody levels induced by so many different types of vaccines. And the antibody levels of all other vaccines are comparable, Sinopharm, AstraZeneca, Moderna, Pfizer, and Novavax. But the Sinovac and neutralizing antibody levels were much lower than other vaccines. And the T-cell responses were only reported by certain manufacturers. Now, coming just to the last part, about vaccine-enhanced disease, because in animal models, when they used a SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV-1, the initial SARS virus vaccine, which was inactivated vaccines, DNA-based vaccines, RNA-based vaccines, then VLP virus-like particle-based vaccines, there was disease enhancement when the animals were re-challenged and causing liver and lung damage. So whether it was because of these non-neutralizing antibodies to the spike and N protein causing disease enhancement. Now, especially with the inactivated vaccines. So there is a concern about the inactivated vaccines, whether the inactivated vaccines for the SARS-CoV-2 will cause a similar problem in humans. But in animal models with the SARS-CoV-2, that has not been observed yet. So we don't know. So these are unanswered questions. But everybody knows about the story about the dengue vaccine, where it was given to everybody in Philippines. And subsequently, those who were seronegative tend to have more severe disease when they subsequently actually got dengue, because there was vaccine-induced disease enhancement because of antibody-dependent enhancement. Now, because of that, the whole measles vaccine and other vaccination programs in Philippines came to a standstill, and there was then a measles outbreak. So we have very good vaccination immunizations programs in Sri Lanka, whatever decision we make, we have to make sure that because of some vaccine mishap, this public trust is not broken. So just to summarize, we have so many vaccines, 10 vaccines undergoing phase 3 clinical trials. The data released into the media looks promising, and when the data vaccine trials are finished and published in peer review journals, we will have the safety data and we will be able to draw better conclusions. And of course, if you're looking for herd immunity, Dr. Razia just said that, I mean, it's not impossible to get herd immunity through vaccination very soon, so it will have to be targeting certain groups. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Neelika, for that very comprehensive analysis that was shared with us about the different types of vaccines that are out there. Thank you. And would like to remind the participants to type in their questions if they do have any questions on the chat box. And I would ask the resource persons to have a look at the questions and answer if possible. Now to move on to our last speaker of this session, who is going to deal with another very important area while we await the vaccines, that is to diagnose the infection properly. So it's Dr. Naomi Dantanarayana who is going to speak on diagnostic tools. She's a consultant medical virologist at the teaching hospital Karapitiya. And without further ado, I would like to invite Naomi to make a presentation. Over to you, Naomi.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, madam. Let me share my screen. Okay. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, madam, and thank you for inviting me for this webinar. I will be talking to you on a much discussed topic like the vaccines, the diagnostics on this COVID-19 platform. So in my presentation, I will be highlighting you the importance of laboratory diagnosis, the overview of tests available and their utility, and some of the factors contributing to the performance of the diagnostic tests. So as we all know that laboratory diagnostics play a pivotal role in managing this outbreak, starting from the beginning, the first cluster of unusual respiratory virus infection started in Wuhan, China, last year. Just to highlight a few points, this is just another respiratory tract infection, and majority are asymptomatic. So this pre-symptomatic and asymptomatic people can transmit the disease. Therefore, the laboratory diagnosis is very much important to diagnose to the clinical patients and to contact trace and for infection prevention and surveillance. Few words about the virus, which will be important for the diagnostic test. So this is a coronavirus, as you all know, and this falls into the beta coronavirus category. And this is the seventh human coronavirus, which was discovered, has a very close resemblance to the SARS coronavirus 1. And this is envelope virus, which is a single-stranded RNA particle, which is this, and which is covered with a protein coat called the nucleocapsid protein. It also has another outer covering, which is called the envelope, and then another spike called the spike protein. So these proteins are important in the diagnosis. So let us look at the viral and the immune markers for this infection. So once a patient is exposed to the coronavirus, they will go into the incubation period, which is about 2 to 14 days, roughly about 7 days if we take. They will have symptoms after that. So even before the start of symptoms, there are viral markers in their respiratory secretions that we can detect. If you can appreciate in this graph, the virus and the viral RNA where we would detect with the PCR will be detected even before the onset of symptoms in a symptomatic patient. So after the onset of symptoms, the viral markers, the nucleic acid and the antigens will peak, and within the early convalescence, that means around 7th day onwards, the immune system comes into play and the antibodies will start to appear. Once the antibodies start to appear, the viral markers will go down. So when you consider the diagnostic tools for the initial period of infection, that is during the pre-symptomatic period and the early infectious period, that is up to about 7 days of starting of symptoms, the virological test would be the ideal markers for the diagnosis of infection, that is the viral RNA, the viral antigens, or the viral proteins, and we also can culture the virus, which is not of much use for the acute diagnosis. And after the acute infection, during the early convalescence, that is about 7 days and onwards, the serology will play an important role in coming to a diagnosis. So when you consider any laboratory test, the laboratory test, the sensitivity, specificity, and the reliability will all depend on some of these factors. That is, we need the correct sample. We need it to be properly collected and packed and properly transported to the laboratory and should be stored in proper temperature conditions until the sample is tested. So a little bit on this, on the safety measures also, when we are collecting samples and performing, personal protective equipments are also very important. So when considering the virological tests, the preferred sample is the respiratory sample. The best samples would be a lower respiratory tract sample like a bronchoalveolar lavage or an ET secretion. But if that is not possible, we can go for upper respiratory tract samples like the nasopharyngeal swab and oropharyngeal swab. So for PCR, for the detection of RNA, the samples we would prefer to be collected into the viral transport media and should be packed in ice, that is to maintain +4 centigrade temperature, and should be transported into the laboratory within 48 hours of collection so that the sample will be properly secured until it reaches the laboratory. So for safety measures, the sample has to be packed in the triple package and sent to the laboratory. So what are the indications for virological tests? This actually is from the ministry circular that I have obtained. So any patient with respiratory tract infection with the travel who is returning from a foreign country or a close contact with a diagnosed or probable case of corona or has been residing in a high-risk area for corona would be a candidate for testing. And also a patient who is having acute pneumonia or respiratory distress with an unexplainable cause would be also a candidate for corona testing. For asymptomatic patients, if there is an epidemiological link to a suspected or confirmed case, these people are also candidates for corona testing. So let's look at the tests in detail. So for virological tests, the most popular tests are the molecular tests. So among them, the most popular one that we use routinely is the real-time polymerase chain reaction. There are other methods coming up, but currently the most popular one would be the real-time polymerase chain reaction. So here we detect the viral RNA. We can detect the viral RNA a few days before the onset of symptoms and up to about few weeks after the infection, which sometimes would give us problems, as we all know. So we don't detect the whole virus. There are few genes which are important for us to do the diagnostics, which are the N gene, the E gene, the S gene, and few other important genes. So usually in a diagnostic test, we wouldn't go for just one gene. We would like to have two gene targets so that we will increase the sensitivity and specificity of our diagnostic test. So in this PCR test, if we start with a small amount of virus, at the end of the test, the virus is amplified million times, which will increase the detection capability and which will increase the sensitivity. We also use several other genes just to quality control the test. And when you consider these PCR tests, they are the gold standards up to now, and they have the highest sensitivity and specificity among the currently available tests. But there are limitations also. They are very expensive and it's not available everywhere. The molecular laboratories are limited. And compared to the rapid tests, which are now being introduced into the market, they take some time to get the results. The other most important thing is, like any other test, the sensitivity would depend on the sample, the sample collection, and the transport, so storage and processing. So just to give you a small just to give you some data from the literature, this is to compare the sensitivity of different samples when you do PCR on respiratory samples. So the highest sensitivity has been observed in lower respiratory tract samples, the bronchoalveolar lavage. Nasal swabs and throat swabs have shown lower sensitivity compared to lower respiratory samples. But when we combine the nasopharyngeal and the oropharyngeal swabs, the sensitivity would increase. And this is just to tell you, like, when you send the sample to the laboratory, people would expect quick results. But just to, I don't know whether you would get some idea how complicated this test is. This is not just one step test. There are several steps which you have to perform. The first one, which is the most cumbersome and time consuming one, the extraction, which we process the sample to take out the viral RNA, and then we have to make the reagents for the reaction, and then you mix the reagents with the extracted RNA, and then you load the PCR machine just in the PCR machine, the test would take about 1.5 to 2.5 hours to run. So after that, we have to do validation and verification of results. And any sample which show a sigmoid curve which rises above the test cutoff, we would give as positive. So it is not that simple, but this is just for your understanding. A positive sample will give a sigmoid curve which rises above this cutoff. So that's about the PCR. Let us go into the next important virological test, which is being discussed vastly during these days. So that is the coronavirus antigen test. Here we detect the coronavirus protein particles, which I have showed you in my previous slides. Basically, the antigens which we take into consideration would be the S protein and N protein, because they are the most abundant proteins in the virus. So here what we have to understand is this is a complementary test to PCR, but it will not replace the PCR, because the PCR test has advantages over antigen test in certain circumstances. These antigen tests come as immunochromatographic tests now, which we call in the lay term the rapid test. So there are two WHO recommended rapid tests in the market, which I have listed the sensitivity and specificity down below in this slide. So WHO recommend the rapid test to be more than 80% sensitive and more than 97% specific. And the positive predictive value, that means if the sample becomes positive, to be sure that the sample is actually positive, and the negative predictive value, if the sample is negative, we should be sure that the sample is actually negative, will depend definitely on the prevalence of the infection in that particular area. When you consider this rapid antigen test, they do very well when the viral load is very high. The sensitivity is very good when the viral load is very high. So what is the place for the antigen test when compared to PCR? So if we want very urgent results, like say to manage a patient urgently and we can't wait until the PCR test is available, in that case, the rapid antigen test is very important. And then if the antigen test is positive, then you can diagnose the patient earlier than the PCR. Then you can contain that patient, which will help you to control transmission and then mitigate the impact of the healthcare and social care settings. And then the other thing is, we can use this antigen test in identified clusters or in outbreak management in specific settings. So just to give you a brief idea how we perform the antigen test, so the nasopharyngeal swab will be taken and it will be inserted into a buffer and mixed, and then this mixture, few drops of this mixture will be added to this antigen kit. Here we are at the sample. If the sample is positive, we would see a line parallel to the test line. So that is this kit shows a positive antigen test. So we know the advantages. It is rapid it's more affordable. You can perform it as an individual test, and you can also use this for point of care testing, but there are few disadvantages. When compared to PCR, the sensitivity is less. And then the disadvantage just a point would be when you take the sample for antigen test, you do it and you have to throw the sample away. You cannot use that sample for any other testing. So unlike the sample for PCR, so you'll have to take another sample if you want to virus characterization or so on. Very briefly for virus culture, here we detect the viable virus. So this is also a virological test where you can use the samples during the early infection, but we don't have the facility in the country to do virus culture because it needs a very sophisticated, very protective laboratory, which we call the biosafety level 3 and above laboratory, where you have the complete sealing of laboratory with negative pressure and positive pressure suits to handle the sample. The important thing in this test will be that we will be detecting the live virus, unlike the PCR. In PCR, you would detect the tail end of the infection, where you would detect the dead virus also. The PCR will be positive at that point. But for virus, if you do the virus culture, you will only detect the viable virus. But this is not used for routine diagnostics. So a little bit on corona antibody test also, for the completeness sake. So definitely you know this, this is not for acute diagnosis because the antibodies will take some time to appear. When you consider antibodies, there are two proteins which antibodies would be direct mounted from the immune system, that is the S protein and the N protein. And there are several types of antibody tests available in the market, the immunochromatographic test or the rapid test, and then ELISA test or the chemiluminescence test, which is the most popular. The immunochromatographic test, we don't have any at the country which have been registered or having good performance, but we have limited facility for the ELISA and chemiluminescence test in a few laboratories, and the neutralization assay, I think that is also available at Jaipur. The most important thing when considering the antibody test is the specificity, because the problem will occur if you give a positive result to a negative patient. Like say, if you do a community survey with the antibody test, if you get a positive result which is actually negative, then there will be a lot of impact in the society, and also you get a false sense of security. So the guidelines recommend for these antibody tests to be very specific, and the sensitivity also should be more than 90%. And the positive predictive value and the negative predictive value of these results will definitely depend on the prevalence of the infection in that area. Just to show you how the diagnostic accuracy of the antibody test, by around seventh day of infection, around 30% of people will show an antibody response, but almost all will show an antibody response after about 3 weeks. And the place and few important points for antibody test. The researchers say that there's no advantage of detecting IgM antibodies over IgG because both occur similarly, almost at the same time. And the other important thing that we have to know is not all will show a detectable antibody response. That is, for mild and asymptomatic infections, the antibody response will be weak and we will not be able to detect it. So basically, the antibody response have correlated well with the clinical severity. And the other thing is, when you have antibodies, it may decrease the person's infectiousness. That means the viral load will be low when you detect antibodies in that patient. So what we don't know is whether this antibody response will offer protection for reinfection and whether how long this antibody response will last. So indications for use. So currently we use the antibody test for as a discharge criteria, and also we use this antibody test to clarify the PCR results, which when it is discrepant. So those are the two indications we are using the antibody test currently. But there is a place for antibody test in community surveillance in cohorts with high probability of exposure. So the recommendations say not to use this antibody test in all communities, but specifically to increase the positive predictive value of this test, we have to use this antibody test in populations which has a high probability of being exposed to this infection. And when you choose an antibody test, it's very important that we go for a very antibody test with high specificity. So in summary, when we select a diagnostic test, it's very important we have that we consider the clinical stage of illness, the sensitivity and specificity of the test, and the availability and affordability, and also most importantly the prevalence of the infection in that area. So I have to say this diagnostic tools are not the only measure to curtail this infection. These diagnostic tools are important, but they should be in use in combination with clinical and epidemiological interventions if we want to contain this infection successfully. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Naomi, for that very informative presentation. I think you can have a look at the chat box. And in the meantime, especially for Neelika, maybe if you want to explain any of the answers that you have given for the said questions, maybe this is the time. Thank you so much.
Yes, so I think we didn't. One question was percentage of the population that needs to be vaccinated for the whole country to develop herd immunity. I think I mentioned that in my presentation that the calculated one is like 80%, 80 to 85%. Some calculations say 70, 75%. So basically over 70% of the population should be immune either through vaccination or by natural infection to prevent transmission within the population.
Thank you, Neelika. Naomi, if you want to answer any of the questions.
Somebody was asking about pooling of samples, madam. Regarding pooling samples, actually we at the moment also we are doing pooling of samples, but then when you pool, we can't pool all samples. The pooling will depend on the whether the samples that we pool will have high probability of being positive. So only we pool samples only when they come from low prevalent areas, or if the sample batch has a low risk of being positive, we pool those samples. But the other thing is, like in other countries, they use fully automated systems when they do these samples. They don't have any human touch in between. So they are but in Sri Lanka we do most of the time manual extraction, so we can't go up to that level of pooling. So at the moment, like, we would pool a lesser number than they would recommend. So because we don't want to hinder the sensitivity of the test. So we do pool, but the pooling will depend on whether the sample batch has a risk of being positive or not. So if the samples come from an area with a high risk of being positive, we will not pool those samples.
Thank you, Naomi. And maybe Indika might have more questions that he has picked up. Indika?
Yes, there are a few questions. I think most have been addressed. One question is coming from the chat. I think, can antigen test give false positives due to infections other than SARS-CoV-2?
I will answer that question. So basically, these antigen tests have been widely validated in populations, actually symptomatic populations. So according to the validations done, large validations done, the specificity, that means giving a false positive result, is very, very low. Not that it can't happen, it's not 100%, but the sensitive, the specificity is very, very high in this antigen test. That means if the test is positive, it being a true positive test is very, very high. The problem with this antigen test is the sensitivity. You might not detect a very low viral load. So sensitivity is the problem. Specificity is fine, but when the prevalence is very low in a population, there could be problems with the specificity also. So that is why it's not just a technical decision when you interpret results. So when you interpret results, we interpret it as a whole. So we look at the we look at the clinical information and the probability and everything, and from where the sample has come from. So if we have any doubt, we always go for other tests. It's not just for antigens. Even the PCR can give rise to false positive results. So that is why when we interpret, we take everything together and interpret. It's a clinical valid interpretation that we give. So if we have any doubt, there's always allowance to repeat or do other tests to confirm.
Thank you. There seem to be a perception that antigen tests can be used as a screening test, even though the guidelines clearly say that it is to measure the infectivity and for the public health response. Can you explain that?
Yeah, antigen test can be utilized as a screening test, but if the population, the prevalence of the disease is low in that population, the positive predictive value, that is, if the test becomes positive, we are not quite sure whether the test will actually be positive. But if the test is negative in a low prevalent area, then we can our chance of that test being a true negative test is high. But in populations with high prevalence, like a high risk population, for example, like in these quarantine centers or where you would find expect positive patients, the screening test will give us very useful. When you use the antigen test as a screening test in a low prevalent population, you will not be able to find positives, but you will be able to find the negatives confidently. But if you use them in a high prevalent setup, you will be able to find the positives soon. So actually, you cannot, that is why I'm telling this, these tests all depend on what do you want to detect and the prevalence of the disease in that population. So you can use this for screening, but then there are when you interpret it, you will have to take everything into consideration.
Thank you. And we have another very important participant among us, Professor Malik Piri. Sir, would you like to make any remarks?
Hi. No, I think, there's been excellent discussion, and I agree with the points that have been made. I don't have any other comments. I mean, I think one thing I would like, I don't know whether Dr. Pense is still online, but I think one thing that we need to be thinking about when we are talking about introducing vaccines is to educate and prepare the public, because whenever you're introducing a mass scale vaccination, as you know, there are always adverse effects in the population. There is a Guillain-Barre, there's transverse myelitis, there are heart attacks, various things taking place without vaccine. So once you introduce a vaccination campaign, very soon you're going to see patients who have been vaccinated, people who have been vaccinated, who will develop these various diseases. And then you have a huge backlash, because immediately people will say the vaccine caused this. So I think it is very important that we start preparing and educating the public about these issues now. Otherwise, you'll find the vaccination campaign could collapse very quickly. Over, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Any concluding remarks from Dr. Asia Fensi?
Thank you, Professor Indica. I mean, I would just like to second what Professor Peter said. And that's why I said it's very important to have a communication strategy, especially in terms of educating the communities. And given that this vaccine is coming in a very short time, and already there's a lot of social media buzz around it. And this is the first pandemic in the age of social media, and we have seen how disruptive it can be. It's a fantastic way of reaching out, but it also leads to the infodemic, and that management is extremely critical. I would just like to thank SLMA and specifically you, Professor Indica. It was a fascinating session, and actually I enjoyed it, and I was there throughout the presentations. So thank you very much. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Asia Fensi, WHO representative of Sri Lanka. And on behalf of Sri Lanka, I would like to thank all the resource persons and Sri Lanka College of Microbiologists for the collaboration and the partnership regarding this very important seminar. And I thank all the participants for the important and very, very impressive interactive discussion and their participation, because they are, from the very beginning, we could say that there's a lot of interest. And it's very important because this kind of topic has generated a lot of interest. And today's discussion, I think, has generated a lot of knowledge, a lot of correct understanding, and maybe way forward to a rational use. And with all these important discussions will be available in our social media and the YouTube channels and the continuous professional development platform, so that it can be used for the future use as well. So with that, we conclude this session, and thank everyone and have a good day. Thank you.